What are the first things you think of when you hear command and control? Authority? Perhaps government? Regulation? Order? So-called command and control policies are underpinned by all of these concepts. Governments commonly use this approach to tackle serious environmental issues, such as water pollution and waste disposal. In the context of climate change, command and control policies are generally focused on setting limits on point source emissions of greenhouse gases. These come from stationary sources, such as power stations, or non-stationary sources, such as vehicle fleets. Firms are legally required to comply with the regulation. In other words, in one way or another, governments make it illegal to emit greenhouse gas emissions under certain circumstances. Such policies are enforced by the state through hefty fines for non-compliance or potentially even criminal prosecution. In this respect, command and control differs to carbon pricing policy instruments, such as carbon taxes or emissions trading schemes, which seek to incentivise emission reductions rather than demanding they be halted under law. In a nutshell, command and control policies involve setting an environmental standard, setting a performance standard, or forcing the use of a specific technology. Environmental standards are centrally driven by government and may include a numerical limit on a pollutant or an outright ban. A good case in point of an environmental standard is the Montreal Protocol. In the late 1980s, governments around the world formed an international agreement to ban chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs, which were destroying the Earth's ozone layer. The need to stop damaging the ozone layer was so urgent that banning CFC emissions was considered the only viable policy option when compared to pricing and targeting mechanisms. These alternatives often take time to have any measurable influence and thus were deemed ineffective in this case. So that's environmental standards. Performance standards, on the other hand, address emissions efficiency. They introduce a limit on the amount of greenhouse gases that can be emitted per unit of output of a product or service. For example, governments may progressively set minimum fuel efficiency requirements for new vehicles that can be sold within a country. Japan, for example, has a target of all passenger vehicles to achieve an efficiency rating of 4.9 litres of unleaded petroleum per 100 kilometres by the year 2020. This policy reduces fuel use and therefore the carbon intensity of a country's vehicle fleet when measured on a per mileage basis. Performance standards may also be applied to stationary point sources such as power stations. The government may mandate, for example, a maximum carbon intensity per megawatt hour of electricity produced. Power stations must keep their carbon intensity below this threshold or face penalties. Technology forcing is another command and control tool. A recent example can be seen in Australia, where the government is phasing out inefficient incandescent light bulbs in favour of compact fluorescent lamps and LED technology. Both of these alternatives use substantially less power. Other examples of technology forcing include requiring pollution control devices to be installed on new vehicles and fuel switching from gasoline to ethanol blended biofuels. Command and control approaches can be coupled with informational tools, such as energy rating labels on consumer white goods and cars. These labels increase consumer awareness of the financial and environmental benefits of more energy-efficient appliances. In summary, command and control policies seek to limit point source emissions of greenhouse gases through regulatory means and through imposing civil and criminal penalties on non-compliance. But command and control is just one option in the climate policy toolbox.